That cannot speak in our hearts. Thank you, Lord. I pray that your word will become a revelation this morning. In Jesus' name we are praying. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Can you sit down, please? I just want to encourage everybody, take your phone, switch it off. Just take your phone, switch it off. You know, when we go to meet the big people, let me just say the minister of South Africa. I don't know whether there's a prime minister here. They are ministers in categories in some countries. They are ministers in categories. When you go to meet the president, there's no way you want to, you are put for audience with the president, if at all they even grant it to you. You go and enter there with your phone, man, green, green, car. They'll first check you at the door, seriously. So because you respect that person, sometimes we'll come before the Lord, we don't respect God, we allow our phones to just ring carelessly. Switch it off, don't put it silent, because it's temptation. And if you are using a phone as a Bible, I want to encourage you, buy a Bible. It's very tempting when you use a phone as a Bible. Don't use it, because something will just come and you say, let me just see what this person is saying. And you turn there, so you see now, oh, you are distracted. So it's good to be disciplined. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I want to bring some greetings. I've been owing this church a lot of greetings. When they say greet the church, I just say, yes, daddy. Then I don't greet. Yes, sister, I don't greet the church. Hallelujah. I want to greet this church. And as I'm greeting the church, can you just shift ahead? Please shift ahead. There's no need. We should know that we have to do evangelism. Except somebody is carrying a baby. Sister Tande, you should sit in front here. And Sister Mirabel, if you don't mind, but if you mind, you sit there, because we are people of Dominion. Hallelujah. So, also, some people can shift in front. It's good not to stay too much behind, so that if the latecomers who are too late, you'll sit behind. Hallelujah. So, I want to bring greetings from my spiritual father and your spiritual father, Bishop Temi. He has always been sending greetings, but I don't give it. I repent of that. And he said I should greet the church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
One day you are going to see him here. I also bring greetings from Dr. Janet and the husband, Lucas. They are elderly people like us who will be coming to minister from USA, will be coming to minister to us. Here, the program, they will start. They will start then, Pastor Felix will also come. Or Dr. Felix too will also come later on in November. So this October we're having a program, November we're having a program. We are rich. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God is blessing us. They are saying we should raise 5,000. It's not even for them. It's just for us to prepare. 5,000 is not even enough. Because you cannot pay somebody's transfer from Cameroon to here and back for 5,000. You cannot pay somebody's transfer from America to here for 5,000. It's for the preparation. God is blessing us that they are coming for, they just decide to spend and come and bless us. And we are so happy. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I want you to give with excitement, and I want you to prepare to invite 10 people. I mean 10 people that will come here. Not 10 people that I've invited, only 2 or 1 or no. No. Begin to talk to people and say, a program is coming up. Next week we'll be giving the team, or on Wednesday. Hallelujah. So, greetings in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I want us to look at our newsletter. We'll see the hymns that we sang here with the choir. Take My Life, Let It Be. We'll sing some stanzas there. Hallelujah. We'll see stanza 1, 4 to the end. We'll sing 1, skip to 4. And then today, it will seem, take my life, let it be, take my silver, and then go down. Hallelujah. Turn to page 7 of your newsletter, page 7. You'll see the song there. Take my life, we can stand up and sing again. Take my life, let it be, consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days. Take my silver and my gold, not a mine would I withhold. Take my intent.
be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour at thy feet its treasures lay. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee, only ever all for thee.
Father, it is our desire. We surrender to you this morning. Lord, even as your word comes, we surrender that you should take our lives. We hand our lives to you. Oh God, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, Father, you are going to honor the confession of our mouth through this song this morning in the name of Jesus. Amen. And we sit down. That's a song of dedication. I like songs of dedication because they make you stronger. They make you think about God. Hallelujah. They make you think about God. So this day, today we are going to be talking about the narrow road. The topic will be that only the narrow road leads to eternal life. That's our topic this morning. Only the narrow road leads to eternal life. Hallelujah. You know the word narrow road. If you want to say, they call it metaphor, don't mind about those things. Oh, it's a word that indicates that when we are going through heaven using the right way, there will be pressures, there will be afflictions, there will be trials, there will be temptation that we'll face on the way as we go to the narrow road, that as we go to heaven. So our Christian journey to heaven is not bread and tea. It's not just anyhow. Hallelujah. Amen. Nowadays, it is strange to many people. Nowadays, it sounds not good to many ears. Nowadays, to hear that the road of heaven is narrow, to hear that it's difficult, to hear that there are temptation there, to hear that there are trials there, many of us will not like it. How many like to hear that there are trials on the way to heaven? There are temptation. How many people like to hear it? Nobody likes to hear it. But that's the truth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Nobody really likes trials, temptation, affliction. Nobody really likes. But that's the way to heaven. The narrow road. And it is the only road that will take you to eternity. If you take another road, well, you will miss it. Hallelujah. So where does the narrow road begin? We say it is a narrow road that leads the Christian, that leads the believer, that leads the children of God to heaven. Where does it start? If you don't start properly, you may miss it. The starting point is always a word that is familiar. Some people, they use it. I don't know whether they use it as a mockery when you want to say something is too simple. Somebody told us that in their house, whenever they cooked cabbage, because to them cabbage was one of the cheapest vegetable, what? When they are coming from school, they say, "What did you cook?" They say, "John 3:16." Then they'll frown their faces because they know that cabbage and pap. So it is the most simplest word. It's the word that you wake a child from the bed and say, "A man must be born again. Say you are born again, cannot see the kingdom of God." But to really, really grasp the truth of that word and become born again, that's the way it starts. It starts with being born again. It starts with coming to a point in your life that you see that the life that I live is useless without Christ. It's meaningless. Even though the Christian journey to heaven is a narrow road, but I want to tell us that narrow road has beauty in it. It has satisfaction. I'm saying like somebody who has been traveling this narrow road since my youth. And that's where I have my joy. That's where I have my peace. That's where I have my satisfaction. Hallelujah. When you begin by being born again, realizing the world cannot give you what you have been longing for. Because you will try and in this way will fail you. Even the money that we're looking for, some people have this money, they cause suicide. Why? It doesn't satisfy. It is a necessity. It is a servant. The money is a servant. But without Christ, it is useless. It cannot satisfy the gap in man's heart. When God created man, he created man in the image, in his own image. And there's a gap in man's heart. And without God filling that gap, you can never be satisfied. Without God coming in to take his place as you are created, you can never be satisfied. So when you have reached a point that you see, I have no way else, you say, Jesus, I need you. Come into my life, forgive my sins, take over my life. I'm not saying that you blame your uncle, your brother, your sister, the circumstances of life, or you are bitter with God, as one lady told me, I'm very angry with God. No. And I'm not saying that. You come to that point, you hand your life to Jesus. And you know what Jesus does? He transforms you. Hallelujah! Amen. We'll soon be standing up. We'll soon be standing up and sitting down so that nobody should blame the eye. We'll all be doing a job. You'll be crushing your neighbor once in a while. Say, are you hearing what is being said on the pulpit? Then we'll not blink our eyes. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, born again, I will not stress on that. That's the starting point. And it is striking, brethren. It is very striking to know that to give our life to Jesus is very easy. But to continue on the narrow road, that's where it is. Hallelujah.
Amen.
To continue on the narrow road is not an easy issue. The narrow road. So, the narrow road starts with being born again. And secondly, the narrow road starts with being available, accountable, and committed in a local church. In a local church where you find yourself. Many people don't want to be committed during this, I don't know what a world of postmodernism, world of end time. Where are you committed, brethren? Many people will jump from here today, jump, seeking for what is already before you. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is what you need. Hallelujah. It is Jesus we need. Jesus is the person we need. So if you find him and find a place that you can hear the sound word, sit there. Don't jump from place to place. Because when they tell your story, how you were last night and your life is not changed, it doesn't make sense. You go to that one and hear, go to that one and hear, go to that one and hear. Sit where you can have food that will prepare you for eternity. After all, that's the whole reason for Christianity. Otherwise, I'll sit in my house. I have a lot of comfort too. We are sitting here like this. If we're at home, we will not have things to be doing. We will not enjoy some things. Can we not go around just even doing eye shopping? Even just going around touring Cape Town and enjoying. But you are here because you want to make heaven. Am I right?
Yes.
You are here because you need God. You are here because you need a father who cares for you. And it doesn't end here. He is preparing a place for us. So when you find yourself in a local assembly, remain there. Being available means that let them see you there. Being accountable means that let, just say, I will not be in church. I will be here. Just being accountable. Let them know that you are part of that body of Christ in that place where you are. That's accountability. People can testify about you there. Hallelujah. After giving your life, being committed, doing something for the Lord where you find yourself. It may just be a little assignment, you start there. It may just be a choir, it may just be a sweeping of the church, maybe just putting water, maybe just coming early and helping to clean the chair, maybe an intercessor. You know, intercession is something that many people is not popular. You just start there, you'll be available, you'll be accountable and be committed in that place. If you read John 17, Jesus Christ gave an account of his life, you just write it down. Because we are talking about the narrow road, we want to focus on that. But if you read John 17, you see, John 17, Jesus was giving an account to God of how he has served him on earth here. He started by praying, these disciples were your own, you gave to me. I've taught them your word. I've finished the job you have given me. Now I'm coming back. An account. When you stand before God on that day, you can't give an account except you know how to walk on this narrow road. Hallelujah. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, the Bible says, I think somebody should read that. It says, I think it's a place, it's talking about us that these things that we have heard, I don't know what 1 Timothy was like. Is it like, is that read? Let me hear. 2 Timothy 4, 2.
4, 2.
It has one.
Preach.
Two, yeah. Okay. Preach.
Verse 2. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season.
Yeah.
Reprove.
Yeah.
Rebuke. And exhort.
Yeah.
With complete patience and teaching.
That's commitment. You know, Paul was talking to Timothy about his own commitment to preach the word, to rebuke. That was his own area. You have to be committed. You might not be able to preach the word, but you can do something. Hallelujah. Maybe your own is just to move and encourage the people who are discouraged. You know, some believers come to church and they go and encourage them and discourage them. They sit behind. Not all of us have the gift of encouragement, you know, like that. Hey, I admire some brethren. They mean to encourage you when you are down there, they'll take you up. Sometimes the pastor cannot do that. Hallelujah. Be committed somewhere, brethren. Hallelujah. Those are some of the things that you do while you, to help you move the narrow road. Because if you are not committed, you are not available, you will be dancing up and down. You will not even be focused. Hallelujah. And you drop aside every other thing that wants to disturb you on this narrow road. So, we are talking about the narrow road. We just gave those things like the beginning point. But if we want to read the scripture that talk about the narrow road, I want us to go there now. We start reading. While you are opening to Matthew chapter 13, verse 14. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. Matthew chapter 7, verse 14 and 13. Verse 13 and 14. Hallelujah. That's where we'll be going. And before we read that, I want to tell you something, brethren. You know, Jesus Christ, when you look at Jesus, sometimes you cannot understand him. Hallelujah. If you want to understand him with our human minds, you will not understand this Jesus. Because when you look at Jesus, Jesus is teaching on the narrow road as we'll be seeing just now. He seems to be discouraging people from following him. If you look at it keenly, you think that, Jesus, were you serious? Instead of Jesus saying, join me, see how I'm doing miracle. Join me, let's go. Join me, just join us. The teaching on the narrow road seems to tell people that, don't just join. Don't come. You'll be wondering what is Jesus doing? Jesus said things that will make us have a second thought. Hallelujah. Don't just follow me, but think. Have a second thought. Don't just follow crowd. You know the crowd follow Jesus alone. The crowd, some follow because of the bread. Some follow just to see signs and wonder as it is today. That Jesus is here. Whoa, will he multiply bread? What to eat bread? That Jesus is here. Whoa, what miracle is he doing today? Let's see the miracle. That Jesus is here. Whoa, what prophecy is that Jesus giving? The crowd. But Jesus did something. Let's read that Matthew chapter 7 from verse 13 to 14. That's the first. We are going to look at these scriptures. These are the scriptures that are talking about the narrow road. Hallelujah.
Verse 13.
Yeah.
Enter by the narrow gate.
Yes.
For the gate is wide and the way is easy. That leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many.
Yeah.
For the gate is narrow and the way is hard. That leads to life. And those who find it are few.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
See the way Jesus is saying. Enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter it. Hey. He first of all gives you the right road to follow. Then he gives another road. And so that road that leads to destruction is broad. And many go through that road of destruction. And some translations, they put the word difficult. Difficult is the road that leads to life. The narrow road. And very few people go there. And you see other Bible passages we'll be reading. It's not many going there. When they say few, it means few in comparison to the number of people who are living on the planet Earth. If you look at, you may think that since Jesus came and went, many Christian, millions of Christians have entered heaven. But compared to the population of the whole world, how many from the population are entering heaven? He said that only few find it. And in Greek, when you want to look at the word difficult, because narrow stands for difficult, it will mean that it is a road that has affliction. Road that is full of affliction, distress, like press. A road that you are pressed like you press grapes to produce the juice. That's the explanation the dictionary, the Bible dictionary gives. And this pressing is what are the experiences that believers who walk the narrow road go through. When you go through the narrow road, you experience things that other people in the world don't experience. You are pressed. Trials come. Temptation comes. But the man who walks the narrow road does anything you want to do. You don't care. Hallelujah. And many people are going through. Because in that narrow road, I can steal. It doesn't matter. I can just cheat. I can just change my balance, my scale balance where I say my fish. It doesn't mean anything. Eh?
Wide road.
The wide road. That's the big road. The big road, I can cheat, I can lie, I can change my balance, I can fornicate, I can cause adultery. If I'm married, if I'm not married, I can fornicate, I can fraud certificates, I can be involved in orgies. You know what is orgies? When they go to parties, they're there dancing. And if you read in Galatians 5:19-21, it will tell you that this sin of orgies, you will not see heaven. You will not see the kingdom. You can write in your book, Galatians chapter 5, verse 19-21. Just write that one and keep. If you take part in those things, you are not walking the narrow road. I'm just naming a few. They are not all here. Hallelujah. And we believers, God has made it that we know what is right and wrong. Amen. When you are born again, the Holy Spirit leads you. You know what is right and wrong. On that day, you don't say, Papa, I didn't know. Because even the Spirit of God in your heart is telling you that my son, my daughter, this thing is not correct. It's telling you. Is it ancestral worship? Hey, my mother died since 20 years ago. I must go and celebrate. The ancestors are angry. All these are things that people in the narrow road do. They have the no problem. You know, in the broad road, in the big road, in the wide road. Because when you want to see the wide road, it's like a road that you can carry even a truck, you pass there. You can carry even a tree with branches. You can go through that big road. No distract, no, nothing disturb you. Some people can carry a big load. You go through. But if you want to go through the narrow road, you have to drop that load at the cross of Jesus. You have to put it at the foot of Jesus, at the cross, and then go in through the narrow road. Those loads are the things that we do anyhow. And God, Jesus was talking to believers, not to unbelievers. He was teaching the disciples that even though you are born again, please don't go through the broad road. Though you are born again, go through the narrow road. You know, there's a philosophy now, a type of teaching that one says safe for all. That if you are already giving your life to Jesus, you can live anyhow and you just enter heaven. It's a lie. Jesus himself has taught us from this place we are seeing. From that Matthew chapter 7, from that verse 13. Enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate And broad is the road that leads to destruction. And many enter through it, even in this world, even in this church. But small is the gate, and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only few find it. So Jesus was teaching quite strange. He would have just said, follow me, follow me. Hallelujah. So the world, what are the some of the things that keep us from going the narrow road? The world. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. The Bible says, the 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. It said, love not the world. Anyone who loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For the love of the world, the pleasures of this world, I'm just saying it for my mind. And all that is in it does not come from the Father, but from the world. So if you are a believer, and you say you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. Are you hearing? If you say you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. You cannot live anyhow and say you love the Father. That's what the 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16 say. Only the narrow road, brethren, leads to eternity with God. Hallelujah. Because eternity is in two ways, you know, like that. Eternity means life that will never finish, has two destinations, only two. One leads to hell, one to lead to heaven. And those who go to that heaven must walk the narrow road. Another scripture that we have to look is in Luke chapter 14, verse 25. Matthew, Mark, Luke, just turn from that Matthew, go to Mark, and then you go to Luke chapter 14. Hallelujah. These are the teaching of Jesus on the narrow road. Chapter 14. Let's look at from verse 25.
Luke chapter 14. From verse 25 to 27.
Large crowds were traveling with Jesus. And turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sister, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. 27. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Let's continue to 28. So, let's hear this story that he's saying here. Suppose one of you wants to be the tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost of to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. 31. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any one of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Are you hearing? Those were the hardcore teachings of Jesus about this eternity we are talking about. Look at his teaching. Hallelujah. Teaching, the Bible says that Jesus was moving and going like this. Large crowd were coming, as we have said, some to see the miracle, some to receive their healing. Because Jesus was healing everybody, even unbelievers. People are healed in this world. Some people are there who are not following Christ, who has tested the greatest miracle of God that you sitting here, you have not tested by Jesus. If that we were just following to eat bread, we were just following to hear your stories, because they are sweet. You use parables, you say nice stories. You seem to have wisdom. The philosophers were following to hear the wisdom that has come from Jesus. Philosophers, they follow for their own reason. Those who follow who were hungry were forced to satisfy their belly. I've come to that church. Since I came to that church, I was coming because I thought they would give me money. They have not given me money. I was coming because I think I'll have a wife or a husband. I don't have. I'm going back. The people follow Jesus for many reasons. I want to ask you, what is your reason of following Jesus? Is it to make eternity? Or you want something that want to take them to turn you back? Jesus' teaching will discourage you. Hallelujah. But if you are following for eternity, the teaching of Jesus will strengthen you and will make heaven in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So as he turned and said, he gave this core teaching. He used the word hate. And this word hate is just to make to say prefer. It's like they call it in big English. What do they call it again, Papa? The word hate, it just means gross exaggeration. It's like to say, the Bible always say, people were like the sand on the seashore. It doesn't mean that people are like sand. It just meant to show that there were many people. So what was Jesus saying here? That if you want to follow him, your love for him must be more than the love for your mother, must be more than the love for your father, must be more than the love for your sister and the love for yourself. What does it mean? It means that if your father will tell you that, stop following God, you will say, I will follow God because I love God more than you, mommy. I know I will care for you, I will still obey you, but I love my Jesus. I will not stop. Even though you love your mother, you will not succumb to him as far as the things of God are concerned. When she gives an advice that is contrary to what the scriptures say, you won't take it. Even though you love your father, if he tells you that, please, I want you to have this man as a husband, you know that man is not a believer. And you know what it means when you marry that man, you backslide, you don't even make the heaven. You'll be able to say, Papa, I love you so much, but please, Papa, can you allow me to have a husband for myself from God? And they will persecute you. They will say, let's go and sit on the ancestors. This Sunday, you are not going to that church. Cool food, we are going to the grave to fellowship. We used to sit there in Bela a lot when we were living in Bela. When we are coming to church, the whole flags, the taxis will carry us, carry the people with flags and flowers. They will drop them at the graveyard, they enter, they fellowship with the dirt. They fellowship with demons. They eat in the graves. The father will say, today, we are going to talk to the ancestors. We are not going to church. The problem is not just going to church, but going to fellowship with the ancestors. You are able to stand and say, Papa, Mama, no. I don't believe. The Bible says I should worship God and him and serve him only. Even as Jesus said when he was tempted, he said that we should worship God only and serve him. Now ancestors are dead. They are gone. They are human beings. Bones are in that thing. We are going there only to fellowship with demons. You are able to take your stand. You are that. If you do that, it seems as you hate your mother. Hallelujah. Amen. Because some of us, the family bond are so much that we'll just succumb, we'll just compromise. And even your own self, we know what the self want. The pleasure of life, this is the weird. The pleasure of life. The pleasures of this life, the self want it so much. The flesh light pleasures. To drink is pleasurable. To dance, they worry music, orgies. What the Bible calls orgy is the kind of dances that go around us in parties. They put smoke, they make whooing, they turn the light, they make some sounds. Then they put the wally. I don't even know whether I can think of one wally music as I'm standing here now. I don't know. Who knows a song that is secular is not of God? Papa said we should not sing it. Because some people don't know the difference. Some people don't know the difference between the church songs and the God song. Everybody knows. Some people just dance anything. They say it's also talking here. So, what you do to join the people to dance like this is, the Bible says it in that Galatians chapter 5 that we are quoted. If you are doing those things, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. I'm not the one saying it. But why do you know why many people do those things? Fear. Cowardliness. They fear the crowd. Oh, they'll say those are the church people, they don't dance. They'll say those are the church people, they don't drink beer. They'll say those are the church people, they do like that. One of the days I was sitting here, they called me to preach it in one of the occasions. They were dancing a song at entry. I wanted to hear what they were dancing. I don't just say amen, anyhow. When you sit in the presence, they are preaching, don't just say amen. Hallelujah. Don't just say amen. Listen to what they say. If it's agree with what you think is right, say amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't just Say amen. They are saying anything, you just say. If they say Jesus will not come again. Yes. Amen. You just say amen to anything. So I was listening to hear what song they were singing. A lady, are you not dancing? I don't dance. I look at her. I'm just dancing now. No, I'm not dancing. Huh? Even when they sing Egwe, then I'm not really hearing what they are exalting the Christians to stand firm, or they are pressing God, or they are worshiping God. I need to hear before I dance. I don't just dance anyhow. Huh? Not to talk of not dancing well with them. Believers don't do those things. Hallelujah. That's a narrow road. If you know your stand, I have my mentor, this one who greeted us. He was a director of an institution. In those our days, there are people to open the floor. He was a director of a school, but he was born again, a man of God. He told us that one day he was sitting there. They knew him, but they keep teasing him. They knew him, they'll keep trying to see that phone, then they go and laugh, and I am God. So, as they started the music, a woman laughed as if the devil entered him. Chick, 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 Tevi. He sat and they said, Tevi. Then the woman danced, read the music, tell no Tevi. Carry the shame. Next time, we'll not do it again. If they call you, they come and open the floor, say, I will not open, I'm a child of God. Next time, as you give that blow to the devil, they will not call you again. Hallelujah. You should dance for Jesus. Oh, even come here, some people dance so much, they don't even dance. They dance for you. We dance here. Somebody say, I don't dance there anymore. La, 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 la. I don't dance anymore where I used to dance. I found a better dance. That's how they're singing. I just forgot the tune of the song. I found the Lord, I found a better way. I have found the Lord, I found a better way. Oh, don't look for me to dance where I used to dance before. I don't dance them anymore. I found a better dance. Oh, don't look for me to dance where I used to dance before. I don't dance there anymore. I found a better dance. Since I found the Lord, I found a better way. I found the Lord, I found a better way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We don't take our time. You have to dance there. That's the narrow road. Don't follow the broad road that leads to hell. Few going. Hallelujah. So the word hate means that you prefer God to all other things. In verse 27, it says, carry your cross and follow me. Carry your cross. What is that cross? It is the persecution, the trials that will go and will persevere. Hallelujah. If you are going through some serious trial and not persevere, if somebody lost a dear person to him, and they say, let's go to the Sangoma and ask why this person has died. If you don't love Jesus, you quickly go. Because that person is dear to you, you quickly go to ask, and you keep asking, and finding, not saving life. Huh? So you must carry that cross and follow Jesus. I don't know some of us. I don't know, Papa Daniel forwarded something to the group last night. Who looked at that? It was a preaching of a man. Yeah. Who in this church look at it? You look at it ever. Poor, you look at it. Ha! Did you hear that testimony of Pastor Bernard? Did you listen? Brethren, we will stand before the Lord with such people there and we will not have a word. That's somebody who has never known even. Hey! Somebody who my mother conceived and went to the doctor and said, I want to abort. And the man said, no. The doctor said, don't abort this child. I will take care of this child. They delivered the child, the doctor was not on duty, 7 months, the child was not breathing. The nurses want to throw in the trash can because it was not breathing. The doctor appeared and said, please, give me the baby. The doctor put in the incubation, sat there, morning till which time till evening, the child started breathing. From there, the child grew up. And I think the doctor passed on what? Something happened. Then this mother, the mother had 5 brothers who were doctors, 3 who were engineers. All them died. I'm just cutting it short. All them died. The mother said, I'm going to prostitution. And he went into prostitution. Oh no, these people died before he went into prostitution. Because out of frustration, he said, better go and leave me in the street. What am I doing? All my people. Can you imagine? You are from that family, you know you're fine. Soon everything they lost. So she went into prostitution, and because of prostitution, she conceived this child, and that's when she wanted to abort, and this doctor too. When the doctor passed on what happened, they found themselves on the street, eating from trash can, living anyhow. So they used to abuse the mother, I'm just telling my own summary. They used to abuse the mother sexually and physically before this little boy. This boy would cry, but cannot do anything, it's a small boy. One day, one person came and said, okay, I'll take you like a house servant. They were happy. They gave them the garage to be living there. No food. They were eating the dog's food. The dog let that one die. The man said, they didn't know where the dog died. Because the dog's food was very rich. So they were eating it. The dog did not have food. The dog even died. They didn't know. So one day, the man will leave his own house, come to abuse the mother in the garage, and beat the mother after abusing. The all time was sodomic way, still beat the woman. This boy will cry. One day the man said, choose, either you are here or your mom. I don't want two people. The boy left. When I entered into a vehicle, under the place that the park load, found himself in the city. It was good because he could eat from the dustbin. Rap, 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 rap. One man came, hired him, he was working for him. Staying in another garage. Then the man used to teach look for teachers to teach his children. There was a hole between the garage and the space where he would teach it. He would keep like that and then learn A, B. That's how he started learning. One day the man caught him and beat him anyway. Your work is to clean the house and do things. It's not to learn. Beat him on the course of beating. He asked him, what is the pattern of
go?
The man said, go. The man was shocked. The boy said, go. That man was shocked. Said, go and join them. So he used to do his work in this seat and also learn with those teachers. Finally, it's a long story. One day we'll shoot that in here. So you hear the testimony. But one day he slept and was stoned by some strange being, or they stabbed him in a dream. In a dormitory where he was going to school, he got up, the leg was swollen, they carried him to hospital. They did their own, he had no money. Then finally, the man who was keeping him in the garage that time took him, went back because they had no money, locked him in the garage, locked him there. He would pull on one side, sleep on one, they locked him so that he would die because there was nobody so that he can just die there. He said one day light came from heaven, bam, the kind of light that he has never seen. Came down and see, he heard, he said, Benny, stand up. He jumped up. When you go listen to the testimony, he jumped up. He had no power, he was paralyzed from here down because of that wound. Because the doctor said he cannot walk again. So he found strength, came, he jumped up, he pushed the gate, jumped out. He was in a place where the dormitory school was somebody working in the school. So the dormitory school was nearby. The girl saw him running and coming somewhere, running away, somewhere confused. Is it not Bernard that we're waiting that he should die? So they said that they saw some white thing on his face. So gathered courage to come and say, Bena, what is happening? Then he started speaking in tongues. The Holy Ghost baptized him. He said, some of these people whom he was living with were Christian leaders. Christian what? He saw no Christ in the Christian leader. He could hear them pray, but they packed him in the garage. The food that this boy he had to throw in the trash can, don't eat. Christian leaders, they never told him about Christ. They never even showed any love. But he is a powerful man of God. If you listen to some story, there are the people who are supposed to sit and be bitter and say life is bitter. And what are the kind of people that have to be complaining? But he made a statement that God is so good. That kind of man. Hallelujah. So pray them. Why am I taking time to tell us this story? To let us know that the road is narrow. And now he's powerful. Go on YouTube, Google Pastor Bernard Ghana. You hear the testimony all over. Hallelujah. Because when I heard, I decided to Google. In that verse 28 to 29, God is also portraying something there. He said that suppose he was telling a story. Suppose You want to build a tower, you must sit and calculate and see the cost. Or if you want to go to war, you must sit down and plan and see whether with 10,000 soldiers I'm able to conquer. This Christian journey is warfare. This Christian journey is like a pillar. Jesus wanted us to understand what it means to be a child of God born again going to heaven. That's what Jesus is portraying here. That in order to go through the narrow road, we must understand the cost and challenges involved. Hallelujah. We must not just take anything goes and say we are entering heaven. We will deceive ourselves on the last day. Yeah. Huh. And in verse 33, it says, anyone who does not give up everything cannot be my disciple. Everything. In other words, to truly follow Christ, we must be the most important thing in our life. That's what they are saying. When they say give up everything, sometimes we're so frightened by those words and say, maybe that God, what do you even have that God has not given you? Everything we have is from God. Hallelujah. You must be able to give up everything if you cannot. So we are saying that what? The narrow road is a difficult road. Hallelujah. In John, just write this one down. In John chapter 6, verse 53 to 66. Just write it down. You'll go and read it for. John chapter 6. Those of us who know that place, we know that that's one of the most hardest teaching that Jesus has given. And people ran away from the church. John chapter 6, verse 53. We cannot read it all. But let me just see how I can read 53. It says that Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat my flesh, the flesh of the Son of Man, and drink his blood, you have no part in me. You have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Hallelujah. 57 said, just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. Hallelujah. The Bible says that in verse 60, on hearing this, many of his disciples said, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept it? The disciples said, now what? This is a hard teaching. Who says so? The disciples. The follower of Jesus. They say, hey, you are going too far, mama. Your own is too much in that Bible of healing. It's too much. We cannot follow. We cannot follow. We better go us to there. After all, there are many places we can go there. It's too hard. And they went away. And in 61, say, aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, does this offend you? What if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The word I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. Hallelujah. Amen. The word of God to us this morning is spirit and life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They went. 66 said, from this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. Then 67, hey, Jesus would have gone to beg them and say, where my church is empty, what will I do? Please come back to church. I don't have offering again. I don't have people to support me again. How will I pay my rent? How will I live? How will we buy food? Jesus instead, so we're supposed to do that. But do you know what Jesus said in verse 67? Somebody read that 67 and 68 from your Bible. Stand up and read it loud. John 6, 67, 68.
67 and 68. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well?
Mm-hmm.
Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life.
Hallelujah. Jesus turned to the 12, because the disciples, there were many people following Jesus, that the follower of Jesus were disciples. But he also had the 12 apostles. So as many of the disciples left, he turned to the 12 disciples. What type of a master is this? What? He turned to the 12. And said, will you not also go? What are you doing here? Go! Other people are going. Hey, this Jesus. Was Jesus doing this because he hated the people? Was he doing it because he doesn't like people? Jesus loved people, that's why he gave his. He loved us. That's why he died for us. Why was Jesus letting them to know that this road to heaven is a matter of life and death? It's a matter of eternity. So sit down and think, am I going to follow the road that will lead me to eternity, or am I going to follow any way? Jesus did not come to deceive us. He came to speak the truth.
Amen.
That's what he was saying here today. He was asking the 12, and one of them had a revelation. Simon Peter said, to whom shall we go? If it's today, say there are many people who can go to heaven. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have the word of eternal life. Peter knew that the reason why they were following Jesus was for eternal life. It was not for here. He said, well, when we are turning to where again, you have the word of eternal life, we will turn to where? The philosopher, they will philosophize. The Pharisee, they will tell us to keep religious rule without you in our heart. The Sadducees, they will say there is no resurrection. And all the seers and all the groups, they will say they are own. Our parents will say we should worship our ancestors. You have the word of eternal life. No matter how hard the road is, we will follow. To whom else shall we turn? Can somebody here say, to whom else shall we turn? To which road? To which road shall we take again? Which road, brethren? Are we going to take the broad road? You think that is impossible? That's just one testimony that we said there. Begin to move in the world. You see believers who are standing. You see them, and they will make them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We had lived our life in the past, but when we hear the word, we should repent. The word of God says, today if you hear God's word, harden not your heart. Soften your heart and walk the road. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the road to heaven, if people tell you that live anyhow, you enter this heaven, it's a lie. Look at the gospel well. You have the Bible too in your house. Read it. These scriptures are given. Read it. And the last place I want us to see how Jesus was talking about the narrow road. That's the last place we're going to see. Hallelujah. So Jesus was saying that we should count the cost. Don't turn back. And that last place is still in Luke. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Go back to Luke 13. That's one of the another striking place there. Jesus talked about the narrow road to heaven. Luke 13. From verse 22 to 24. Somebody can read from the floor. Luke chapter 13.
Then Jesus went through the towns and villages, teaching as he made his way to Jerusalem. Someone asked him, Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? He said to them, make every effort to enter through the narrow door, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to.
Yeah. Hallelujah. You can read the rest of the passage and go down. But what is happening here? Jesus was going through the towns and villages teaching as he went along. I'm sure this person who asked this question had been following Jesus for days, listening to his teachings. Then they were so tough. Then he really said, then they really asked the master for sure whether this thing he's really teaching is true. He went to Jesus. He said, Master, someone asked him, verse 23, Lord, are only a few people going to be saved? From what you are teaching, am I making a mistake? Jesus, are only a few people, and among these millions of people in the world, you mean that they'll go to hell? Only a few people will be saved? What was the answer? Jesus said, he said to them, make every effort to enter through the narrow door. Make every effort. It means there's an effort involved. The Holy Spirit is going to give you grace, but you have to make an effort. If you sleep in your house, it's Bible study, you are enjoying your music, watching your sofas, to live and come to church? To listen to the word that will lead you to eternal life? Or you can decide to sleep you there. You are not making an effort. It can be cold. You say, hey, it's too cold today. Just drink your tea. Sit you. You are eating your peanut. You are drinking your tea. You are watching your TV. You don't go to the E. Sometimes, my sister said used to be going in winter. Some days in winter, I told myself that only the people who love Jesus, only those who go to the narrow road will come to church. Like for Bible study, prayer meeting. If you come to Bible study, if you come to prayer meeting, if you come, you are making an effort. Sunday is the crowd. Everybody goes to church on Sunday. Even still, you don't see the crowd. But Sunday is the day for the crowd. Those who want to follow the narrow road, Bible study their day, prayer their day. Those who choose the meeting, you are not ready to go through the narrow road. I'm not saying that somebody who is working should leave the work and must come and not eat. No. I'm saying that when you have an opportunity, you are free, but you are just, well, I don't just want to go out to wash my clothes. I don't, you don't even know where you are going to. You don't even know. The things that just take us away from God. Simple thing. So Jesus answered, make every effort. Oh, every effort, everything.
Use the inclination of your mind.
Every to go through the narrow road. And the next thing, what did Jesus say? He said, I tell you, because many, I tell you, will try to enter and will not be able to. I wish I have another translation. I don't know whether it's Mercy's translation.
There's one more.
Yeah.
Read another translation.
Verse one.
From verse 24. I just want that 24. Yes.
Okay. The door to heaven is narrow. Try hard to enter it. Many people will want to enter there, but they will not be able to go in.
The door to heaven is narrow. Try hard. Those of you who say it's the mobala, it's rice and beans, it's anything. Try hard. Because
it say in my translation, because it say, I tell you that it say, because many,
how many people will try to enter?
Many
will try to enter and will not be able. Do you not see many people?
How many people went to church today? Look at the
population that went to church today. Even the person who is selling drugs in those houses took the Bible this morning and went to church. Are they not trying to enter? They are trying.
They should try
it. The woman who was in the boyfriend, a married man last night, carried the Bible to church this morning. Are they not trying? They are trying. The person who is not even causing immorality, not drinking, not smoking, but doesn't believe Jesus, just go there for formality. And say, I'm good, after I'm good, let me just go to church, I'm good. They don't see that Jesus need to. They also carried their Bible, they went to church this morning. They are trying, are they not trying? Many are trying, but will not be entered. Only those who make an extra effort. I'm reading the word of Jesus. It's me, not me who read. When I read it, I also tremble. I said, Jesus, why didn't you make it soft? But the grace is there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said in his word in Titus, I think Titus chapter 2, he says that the grace of God that brought salvation has appeared to all man. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passion and to live a godly life in this present. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray, help us. You say there will be no pain there. There will be no tears. You say you will wipe away all our tears. There will be no mourning. All our things are past. This pain that we are feeling in this world, this suffering that we are suffering, this disappointment, this poverty, this all type of affliction in this world, you say you will wipe our tears in the last days. Father, help us to follow the narrow road. Help us It is possible because your grace is there to help us. Father, open our eyes to know you more. Open our eyes to follow you more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, because pain has gone. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. If you want to ask questions, because in such preaching, there can be questions. You can meet me. And I want to tell you, brethren will make them if you can meet them. Hallelujah. I want to encourage you. And I want to pray for you who may be sick, maybe have a problem. I want to pray for you. We are covering our eyes now. We are praying. We are praying now. Whatever problem you have, I don't know. It is being left in this place. In the name of Jesus, every pain, whether it be sickness or the pain of the heart because of problems, I begin to pray, Holy Spirit, touch. Holy Spirit, touch in the name of Jesus. Let that pain of the heart go. Let the peace of God that passes all understanding rule your heart. I pray and rebuke sickness. Every family affliction, I command you, bow in the name of Jesus. I destroy your yoke, Satan, over the people of God. I pray, God, that you open our eyes to cling on you. I pray that you comfort us. I pray that you bless our hands. We are going to walk. The people of the world are also walking. We have spent time before you. We pray, Lord, that our businesses will prosper. In the name of Jesus, our jobs will find favor in our workplace. In the name of Jesus, we'll find favor before you in our academic, before our lecturers. In the name of Jesus, may we be blessed. Hallelujah. Amen.